is the Suwalki corridor still one of the biggest areas that we need to worry about? It's not the only one, but you know, should we be paying more attention to this with such an uncertain Russia?
So I think one of the first things to remember is that certain nations, to include the Baltics and Poland, have been talking about Suwalki for a long time. And I visited there, and this is certainly, in the big scheme of things, in the defense of NATO, it is prime and key land. I think the second thing to remember about those four nations is that if we really look back, say, 20 months ago, towards the just before the beginning of this war, those four nations were vocal and completely right about Russia long before the rest of the West was right about Russia. And so we have nations that are talking to us about how important this land is. These same nations have gotten it right with Russia faster and more often than we have. I believe we need to pay attention.
Do you think that from what you can see now that NATO has reinforced enough?
Well, I would say that I'm going to speak out both sides of my mouth, yes and no. So far, it is my assertion that we have lost conventional deterrence outside of NATO land. I mean, clearly, Ukraine is under attack. Few in the world are talking about the attack that's going on in Georgia. It's more of a political corruption, influence, and money attack. But make no mistake, Russia is acting in Georgia right now and causing massive problems with the political infrastructure of Georgia. Also, make no mistake, Moldova is under attack. I was recently on stage with the Minister of Interior of Moldova. By the way, she is brilliant. And she talked to me through the most demonstrative example set of how the, whatever you want to call it, hybrid war or gray zone war is going on inside of Moldova, emanating from Transnistria. And this country is also under attack. So what we see is outside of NATO spaces, we have lost conventional deterrence, and we will have to regain it. Now, once again, these nations that were right about Russia going into this war are saying that we cannot take our eyes off of their borders because they could be next. So they're batting 1,000 so far. We probably ought to pay attention.
But are they saying that we need more exercises? So what I mean, are they saying that you need to exercise more?
We have gradually increased the size of the force that is on high readiness. But the fact of the matter is the main response to Russian aggression is to put more forces on high readiness. Now, may I just share with you how much I love, respect, and want to lift up my NATO partners. I think you know I served 8 times in Europe, culminating in the SACEUR tour. And so it's a pretty fair bet to say that I'm a NATO supporter. But may I just offer a bit of a difference among NATO forces? And that is, there are a few who actually test themselves significantly on their readiness. And there are fewer of that few that actually exercise then to failure. A lot of exercises are more ceremonial and about the logistics and pulling them off than they are actually testing a force to failure.
Can you name names?
No, I'm not going to do that, because then that makes it all get, you know, less than cordial, maybe I should say. So let's just keep it at this. One of the things that makes American forces credible is because we test ourselves not only on responsiveness, but we test ourselves to failure. And what I would suggest is that now we have actually increased the size and readiness of our forces as a response to Russia. I think it's important not only in the Suwalki Gap, but in on the oceans and in the air and other places. We need to test ourselves first and foremost on our actual responsiveness to the readiness we've declared. But then we actually need to test ourselves in exercises to failure. In other words, we need to give our forces hard problems to solve and force them to think outside the box. It's more than getting to an exercise area and setting up camp. We need to be tested.
Things are going to go wrong and you should want them to go wrong on these exercises, right?
Well, yes, we learn by being exposed to our problems and our failures. And a responsiveness, again, is what we have included in our answer to Russia's attack. We are telling our forces they have to be ready in certain amounts of time. If Russia decides to invade a NATO an area, hopefully we will have good intelligence that tells us to be ready. But we can't rely on it. And also note that if Russia decides to invade and we start to respond, what Russia knows is that if we get our kit to the fight, they lose. So we're not going to get an unobstructed path. We are going to be moving under attack. And one of the great, I think, problems that we have vis-a-vis where we were back in the great checkered flag days or the big movements to Europe days, reforger days, is that back then we had mobile air defense that went with us when we move. We don't anymore. Our air defense forces are so thin that many of our movements are going to be uncovered.
Is more forward basing and more forward stationing of equipment the answer? I mean, this makes the Baltics and Poland feel better. You've got more troops there. You've got more stuff there. This saves you from having to move it from place to place.
It is a part of it. We often overstate so badly that people get not offended, but they are extremely worried by some of the things that are said. Yes, forward basing is important. To me, forward basing troops is important, but maybe even more important is forward basing that kit and supply that troops can then fall in on to rapidly generate combat power. And as we have seen in the Ukraine conflict, having the right kind of munitions forward is as important as anything else. So we still have much to do about how we forward base.
They are talking about now regional defense, regional planning. Is this the most important thing and the most necessary thing that needed to be done right now?
Well, you put sort of a high bar there. Is this the most important? Maybe not. But may I just say that in my day, prior to Wales, the lack of definition and clarity in our plans and regional plans was the biggest problem I thought we had in planning. Because to our point a moment ago, when you have a plan that does not give definition to the forces that are aligned to the plan, it hurts you in the logistics planning to support who is arriving. Yes, some of the very standard stuff, fuel, food, medical supplies, those can be pressed forward. But one of the most amazing things the world learned about the war in Ukraine, and I laugh and it's not funny at all, is that things that we used to think were standard really aren't. How many different kinds of 155 rounds does NATO shoot? This is absolutely absurd. So we have 155 rounds, they'll shoot in weapons from this nation, but not weapons from that nation. So now things that we used to think were easy are hard because we have developed these proprietary rounds that go into some of our most common equipment. So once again, we could be thinking, okay, we need 155 forward. And we get a bunch of 155 forward in country X, and country Y's military shows up and can't use those rounds. We are now in an ugly place of having to move those rounds under fire to get them to somewhere they can be used and then set up the country that's arriving. So I'm not going to speak to any classified. I would just tell you that what this screams is for definition of forces assigned in these plans. Because remember, amateurs talk operations, professionals talk logistics. If country X's forces are going to country Y to defend, and country Z's ammunition is sitting in that country, we have just made a major mistake. And so I believe that definition clears up a lot of these issues.
But this is something that's been evolving, I mean, in the SAC course from your time until now, that countries have to be more specific about what they've got ready, how fast they could move, where they could move. And so that has been happening gradually, but sort of now coming to fruition in this new revamp of NATO's planning, right? This is now, Kavoli should have those things, should have those much more clarity on who has what and how it will work together with whomever else, right? That's something that's been a gradual but big step forward.
Well, we have a lot more, I hate to keep using the word, we need to be adding more and more definition to these plans so that we can understand all the relationships you just talked about.
But doing things regionally and having sort of regional, I don't know, not commands, but regional planning, like as we always said with these plans, as was done before the end of the Cold War, as was done during the Cold War, you think that's the right way to go right now?
I do. And I did before. And while we used to say we don't have regional plans, we sort of, in essence, had regional plans. Nobody thought that the commander in Germany was going to go lead troops in the Mediterranean. And nobody knew that the commanders in Naples were going to come up north and lead troops in the north. We sort of said that, but we actually sort of, in actual execution, had much more regionally focused headquarters, etc. But I'm talking about a whole new level of definition. One of the most interesting conversations that is happening out there now is, as I travel the capitals, I was just recently in five capitals, and I'm going back soon to four capitals. And one of the things that we see is Russia's way of warfare. It is not surgical, okay? It is blunt and crude, and it chews up infrastructure. And all you have to do is look at Eastern Ukraine and you see the way that Russia wages war. And so we have a lot of nations, including some of our non-allied nations, who now have sort of reoriented their thinking. And that is that we want to fight Russia at range. We do not want them on our territory because we now understand that Russia is unable to sort of do what we call high-end maneuver warfare on the battlefield. Rather, they are an attritional artillery-based force, and their approach is very crude. And so nations don't want Mariupol to happen on their land. They don't want Bucha to happen on their land. And so now many nations are talking about, how do I fight Russia at range, and how do I significantly attrit them before they get into my country and start destroying my infrastructure and rubbleizing my country? And so there are multiple nations that are capable now of putting together these teams to do what I call deep strike. And there are nations that are not yet ready, but they are scrambling to attain this. Or in some cases, they know they will never attain it. So they're trying to attach themselves to the alliance or to nations like the United States, Great Britain, and others who are working through this problem to actually have an actual real capability to do that right now. Now, this flies in the face of what we see in Ukraine. Ukraine would like to do that in its periphery. But you know that we in the West, and specifically we in the United States, have built sanctuary for Russia. We forbid Ukraine from using our weapons to do what you're talking about, to strike the forces before they're deployed in Ukraine. That's what we would do if we were there fighting, but you can't do that. So while Ukraine could do that now, we have a policy that forbids them from doing that with our weaponry. I think you're beginning to see Ukraine's developing its own weaponry to do that, and they're beginning to have some successes. But by and large, we in the West, and we specifically in the United States, have, by our policy, built sanctuary for Russia, and that's a problem. So nations, like some you just asked about, are developing very capable forces, procedures, and existing capability to strike deeply and strike the enemy before on our side of the border. Other nations specifically want this because they have witnessed what Russians' style of war is, and they don't want that happening on their soil.